2 hours before the Megillah reading. Tomorrow at this time will be packed here. Everyone must hear the Megillah, men and women, in the evening and in the morning. Purim, even though it's a holiday that was made by the Chachamim, also Hanukkah, Mara says that in the future, after Mashiach comes, it's hard to understand what the Gemara meant, but they say all the holidays eventually will finish, except those two, Purim and Hanukkah, to show you the power of the Chachamim. That's something the Chachamim made, nobody can cancel. Even holidays like Rosh Hashanah, Yom Adin, Sukkot, I guess what it means in the Gemara is that once the third Bet HaMikdash will be built, what's going to be the point of memorizing the destruction of Bet HaMikdash or Zecher Litziat Mitzrayim, because we're going to have a final permanent salvation. Till now, 2,000 years when he exiled, every mitzvah is a memory of the exodus of Egypt. Everything, Kiddush, Zecher Litziat Mitzrayim, Shabbat, Zecher Litziat Mitzrayim, Matzah, Zecher Litziat Mitzrayim, Sukkah, Zecher Litziat Mitzrayim, Lulav, everything connects to Yetziat Mitzrayim. That's one of the hardest questions. The Gemara says that before Hashem gave the Torah to the Jews, He came to every nation and offered them the Torah. How is it done? How Hashem didn't make them a Mount Sinai event. He came to the nations, to the prophet of this nation, like the Goyim had Bilam. There was other Goyim that were prophets. And he offered them, if they're willing to accept the Torah, the prophet came to the nation, they made a vote. The majority of them did refuse to accept it. The minority did agree, but they couldn't do anything about it. So none of the nation finally, after a vote, agreed to accept the Torah. The last option was the Jews. He offered them the Torah. The Jews say, Na'ase v'nishma, we're going to do, and maybe one day we'll understand, but we're going to do, no questions asked. A few things here. First, the Zohar says that all the non-Jews, the Gentiles, that agreed to accept the Torah, but they were forced not to because they were the minority in that nation. So the Zohar says that Hashem gave them a second chance and He reincarnated them in a body of another Goy. But this time He gave them an opportunity individually to convert. And that's why you see, you have billions of Christians here and there. You see one and there that open up their eyes. Sometimes there are some of them that they had a position to see the truth, but they're blind. On the other hand, Hashem brings a guy from the end of the world. He makes a mistake. He lands in Borough Park. Like the speaker is going to speak here on Motzei Shabbos. I'll tell you a story. He ended up in Borough Park by mistake. You know, there's no mistakes. And today is a rabbi giving lectures in Beit Gavriel, Baruch Hashem. Understand? So why him yes and somebody else not? By the way, he once told me that he has, I think, 9 other brothers. And they all converted. They all became Jews. And he had one sister, she's a nun in a church. So, first of all, a family of 10 children by the Goyim, that's already something unique. How many Goyim has 10 children? So I guess his parents had some kind of connection to Hashem already before. Once I heard him saying that his father always educated him to search for the truth. They tried all kinds of cults, but they always saw that it's not the truth over there. Until he ended up in Borough Park. He was invited for Shabbat by mistake until they realized he's not a Jew. But you know, the guy was clever. What would he say? I cannot invite you to the Shabbos table? So I already invited him. So Mishamayim, let's see what's going to happen next. What happened next? Thanks to the guy being clever, he was already making other people religious. Comes to the Jews, he's very emotional, you know. See what's going on, begins to cry, he writes Sifre Torah. A lot of great things came from this convert. You see, this is just one out of who know how many. Then also, we have a big question here. How did Hashem offer the Torah to the Knaanim, to the Yevusim, to the Girgashim, to all these nations, to the Sinim, the Chinese. How? Because everything in the Torah is Zecher Litziat Mitzrayim. The entire list of the mitzvot, it's all a memory to the exodus of Egypt. The Egyptians or the Chinese have never been in Egypt. What's gonna be the point? Let's say one of the goyim will agree. They say, you know what? We made a vote, and we decided to accept your Torah, God. Okay, so what do we have to do? You have to sit in the sukkah. Why? Because when you came out of Egypt, I made you sit in a sukkot. I said, what's Egypt? We've never been in Egypt. What is this? You made a mistake. The Torah doesn't belong to us. It belongs to another nation. How you answer this question? How did he offer them the Torah? Torah is based on the Jews. Really, what came first? The Torah came first, or the people came first? The Torah was already made, before the world was made. So in the Torah, what do you see? Zecher Litziat Mitzrayim. So the truth is, it's interesting. It's a very hard question. Don't think it's an easy question to answer. Which Torah was made before Hashem gave the Torah? Before Hashem created the world, which Torah was really made? Not the exact same Torah with this historical story that you read, the chronological order. That's already a part of history that was pushed into the Torah. Hashem only had a list of 613 mitzvot. What's the original reason for this mitzvot? Not because of Egypt. Even if we were not going to be in Egypt, we would still have mitzvat matzah. We still have tefillin. After the history was designed by Hashem in a way that these things will fall into place in our life in the 5,000-6,000 years that we're going to be here. Yes?
I thought halachas are derived from different codes and stuff from the Torah. It's not only from the places where it says 632 mitzvot. I thought the whole Torah, the rabbi...
No, but yeah, we have a big problem. I explain where the problem comes from. When you ask a person why... do we have to eat matzah? Everybody will answer, Al Shem Shelo Ispik Betzekam Shel Avotenu Lachmitz Bemitzrayim. Translation, because the dough of our grandparents, when they came out of Egypt, they did not have enough time for the dough to rise. Therefore, they ate it like matzot, like crackers. So as a memory of what happened to our fathers, we also don't let the dough rise. And the difference between matzah and bread, there's no difference in the ingredient. It's the same ingredients. Just one is rising more than 18 minutes, the dough. And the other one you must put in the oven before it rises. And then it's why it's become flat, like this. You make holes in it that it won't be puffy, you know. And it's a way to make it, especially to make it like crackers. You know, the Yemenites make it soft, you know, it's like pita. A very not tasty one. It's very hard to eat it because it never rises. Remember, bread that is too concentrate, it's very hard to eat, especially once it's not so fresh. The next day, it's like a rock. But that's called matzah. That's the difference between bread that rises and a bread that never rises. So the truth is, based on what the Chachamim and the Torah says, because our parents had such a bad experience that they couldn't wait in Egypt, they had to take everything and start running out mamash in moments, and they ate the bread as it is, like this. Because of that, every year we eat it as a memory to the exodus of Egypt. But we have a problem. Because the Torah, the mitzvah of matzah, was already existed before our parents were even born. Before Egypt was a country even. There was already mitzvat matzah in the Torah. And that's a big mistake. That we think that because there was Egypt, we have matzah. The truth is that it's the other way around. Go and understand now the secrets of Hashem. First, there was a matzah. Because of matzah, our parents ate matzah. That's it. That's the truth. First, Hashem wrote in the Torah, Kabed et avicha ve'et imecha, respect your father and mother. Because of that, he made you father and mother. That you will have who to respect. So what came first? Not because you have father and mother that raised you and took care of everything you have, and because of that, you have to be grateful to them. That's why you got this mitzvah. No, it's the other way around. First, for whatever reason that only Hashem knows, nobody knows, only Hashem knows, because Hashem wanted you to respect your parents, He made you parents. Hashem wanted you to eat matzah, He directed history to a situation that He will have a reason for us to eat matzah. And if we didn't have the reason to eat matzah, we'll still have to eat matzah. Without, Chachamim will make you a different story. You understand the point here? And that's something that a lot of us don't understand. The reason for the mitzvot of the Torah are impossible to understand. Chachamim, however, they did everything they could to put some kind of an explanation to the mitzvot for us, that it will make more sense to us. It also gives you some kind of flavor when you do the mitzvah, knowing that you do something that relates to your parents, you feel more connected. But the truth is, if you dig inside, what is the reason that we have all these things? Some of them are very strange. We don't understand what's the point here. Don't try to understand. You are not divine. And that's why you don't understand. Rambam say, Ilu yedaativ haitiv. If I knew all the secrets of Hashem, I would be Hashem. Haiti Hashem. I would be Him. The fact that we don't understand almost anything about Hashem makes Him great. If we will be able to understand everything about Him, probably it would be our cousin. It wouldn't be Hashem. You understand the point here? Even people to people, it's hard to understand everything go through your friend's mind. And this is only an ordinary person like you, trying to understand the Creator of the world. It's a little bit, it's close to chutzpah a little bit, trying to understand the secrets of Hashem. So what's the point here? The point here, that first we have the mitzvot. So now when Hashem came to give the goyim the mitzvot, the goyim will accept the mitzvah of eating matzah regardless of the exodus of Egypt. Or the goyim will have to keep the Shabbat regardless of the exodus of Egypt. Or maybe it was all a show. Maybe Hashem already know that the goyim, the connection between the Torah and them is far away. The Torah says that when the future to come, when after Mashiach comes and all that, the goyim will come to Hashem and say, that's not fair. It's not fair. If we would have the condition of the Jewish nation, we'll also be righteous. You gave them Moshe Rabbeinu, you gave them this mitzvot, you expect us to be like them? So, Gemara say a story. Try to understand the story. The Gemara say Hashem will give them and say, okay, you know what? I'm giving you a mitzvah now to do. What is it? Mitzvah sukkah. Sukkah. So they go make sukkah, they go to Home Depot, they buy things, they bring Vinny and Richie to build the sukkah. They come over there with their drill, they build the sukkah. They build it nice, I promise you. They know how to build. So they build the sukkah, they go inside the sukkah, all of a sudden what happened? 120 degrees. They sweat inside the sukkah. They begin to kick the sukkah. They said, the hell with this mitzvah. What is this nonsense? You know, they begin to kick the sukkah, they don't want it. And Hashem said, look, I gave you such an easy mitzvah, even this you don't want. What's the story here? What is it? Hashem is fooling them? Hashem, answer them, tell them, listen, I'm not interested to give you the mitzvot. You can complain until tomorrow. We see that it's important for Hashem that even the goyim will understand this justice. So He gives them one simple mitzvah. He makes a very hard day. And I want to ask you a question. If we would have Sukkot tomorrow with 120 degrees, we would be able to sit in a Sukkah? I promise you, I would run inside to the air condition. You know why? The halacha say you have to run in. If you have 120 degrees out there and you're sweating like crazy, this is painful. It's terrible. You don't enjoy the holiday. The Torah says, "Mitztayer patur me'asukah." If it's too cold, or it's too hot, or you have bugs, or there's bad smell over there, or it's dangerous, or the Arab shooting missiles, half of Israel already, you don't have to do sukkah. In Sderot, you don't need sukkah. Ashkelon, you don't need sukkah. Why? They have rockets falling. It's dangerous as it is. Any territory next to Arab villages, it's dangerous. They can come slaughter you in the middle of the night. So half of Israel, regardless of the weather, is patur misukkah. You don't need sukkah. Now just imagine if it's going to rain, because Sukkot usually it starts to rain. Nobody needs to sit in a Sukkah. You have the Chabadnikim, Chabad. They never sleep in a Sukkah. Why? He cannot bring his wife to sleep in the same room with him, because it's not modest as other people. So since he cannot be with his wife, it's mitzta'er. It's already enough for him not to do it. There's all kinds of explanation. What does it mean, mitzta'er patur ma'asukah? But for sure, if Hashem made such a hot day, what does he want from the goyim? The halacha say, mitzta'er patur ma'asukah. I don't know. Anybody has an idea how to explain this gemara? What do you say?
I was reading this on Shabbos. I think it's the one Avodah Zarah.
Yeah.
And it was talking that he wanted to give them a simple mitzvah because they couldn't do the other one. And then he told them, but you made it so easy for the Jews. You told them that if they didn't accept the Torah, we would drop a mountain on them. So why didn't you do the same to us?
Right.
So he said, I'll give you the mitzvah of the Sukkah because it's the cheapest mitzvah to do.
It's not so cheap. It's minimum $1,000 to build a Sukkah today. Just go buy the schach. You see how expensive it is. First of all, it's not such a cheap mitzvah. There are cheaper mitzvot than this. Talit. You put tzitzit on your body. Tzitzit costs, depend where you buy it. Let's say $35. You buy a tzitzit. Every second it's mitzvah. Much cheaper than sukkah. Much faster. I have a few in the trunks. Every second, mitzvah. That's it here, cheaper mitzvah. Why didn't give a mitzvah tzitzit? But that's not even the question here. The question here, if Hashem made it so hot, they didn't really have to sit in a sukkah. What is the proof to show the goyim that they cannot even sit in a sukkah? If we would have 120, 130 degrees that day, we ourselves wouldn't have to sit in a sukkah. The goyim, they could answer Hashem and say, hey, what are you giving us? This is not, you're torturing us. This is not a mitzvah. Don't you know the halacha? What, the goyim don't know that the Jew is a patur me'asukah if there's 120 degrees? They have what to answer. What's this whole show? I'm going to tell Hashem, what is this? You're fooling us? What's going on here? Give us a nice day, breeze, 65, 70 degrees. We'll sit in a sukkah. Believe me, they enjoy it. The Italians, John Gotti and his son and the other son, they're all going to sit in a sukkah, drink l'chaim, be very happy. I just heard his wife is Jewish. That means his children are Jewish. My mother-in-law just told me that John Gotti married a Jew. That's what she said. She listens a lot to the news. If she say, she probably knows what she's talking about. No? No, he married a Jewish woman. His children, according to his opinions, are Italians. But really, according to the halacha, they have to keep Shabbat. I always cannot understand the goyim that the religion goes by the father. But by them, there are so many families, you never know who the father is. You know what happened in Egypt? When the decree was that every firstborn has to die. So some families, you have two sons falling and dying. Two. A father has 7, 8 children. Remember, there was no birth control by the Egyptians 3,400 years ago. So they had 15 children. All of a sudden, he comes to the house, he sees two of his children are dead. And he said, I don't understand. Everybody has around here in the neighborhood, one kid died. Why I had two? Why? Because one, it's not your son. It's firstborn from two different fathers. That's what Chazal says. Anyway, it's a hard question. If you can come up with an answer for this, I'll be very happy. What was the whole point of giving the mitzvah of sukkah, knowing he's going to make it so hot, the goyim will kick the sukkah? I say, what is this? Who needs this religion? And then Hashem says, you see, even such an easy mitzvah you cannot do. It's not an easy mitzvah. Yeah.
Necessary. They did everything they could to get close to Hashem, even more than the mitzvah required. So
he's trying
to show the goyim that it's not just the mitzvah, it's the heart.
The Gemara says, Hashem said to the nation of Israel, wow, you're beginning to read my mind, I see. Very good. You see that they're cooking here every Wednesday, they're cooking us. Baruch Hashem, very good. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam shehakol nehiya bidvaro. The Gemara says, look at the nation of Israel. The Torah says, ואכלת וסבעת, וברכת את השם אלוקיך. You should eat and be full. After you feel full, you have an obligation to bless your God that gave you the food. And they make a bracha even בקזית וכביצה, that the Jews already blessed Hashem after they eat 1 ounce, which is not even an appetizer. What's 1 ounce? 28 grams? One serious bite from a pita bread, it's already 1 ounce. When the Jews make Birkat Hamazon for that, even though they have to be full. Some people, they can eat 2 pita and not be full. But already from Kazait, we already say it. So we are doing more than what Hashem ordered us. But I promise you, you put the sukkah outside with a very, very hot day, the halacha says, not, you have to understand, mitzta'er patur min ha-sukkah, when you hear it, you think, I don't have an obligation to sit in a sukkah. But I want to be tzaddik. I'm going to sit anyway. I sweat. I suffer. What's the problem? I want to do the mitzvah. But we have a problem, because in Yom Tov, you're not allowed to suffer. In Yom Tov, you're not allowed to do something that makes you sad and upset. Therefore, if you sit in a sukkah in 120 or 130 degrees and you sweat and you suffer and it's itching and you can hardly breathe, it's a sin to sit in a sukkah. You understand? Your friend that went inside to the air condition, enjoying the house, eating inside, he made a mitzvah, and you're sweating in a sukkah, and you made a sin. Why? Ignorance. Remember the last lecture? I named it ignorance dash. What's the rest? The biggest danger to us, ignorance. Nothing is more scary. If you don't know, you make so many mistakes. You go, you suffer 48 hours. You come to Shammai and they say, you fool. I made it very hot because I wanted you inside the air condition. I want you to sleep well. Or sometimes it's too cold. People put, heat and all kinds of things and blankets and they cover their head. Look like, because he wants to do the mitzvah. Then in the morning, he wake up, he's all sick. Why? Because it's not enough to be covered. The air that you breathe make you sick. You can protect your ears, you can protect your head, you can put 10 blankets. We still need to breathe. So the air that you breathe in a sukkah in 30 degrees makes you sick. Understand? Let's go back to Purim. Yeah.
How important is it tomorrow's fast for men to fast, and why are we fasting?
Well, if you want to really know the truth, from all the fast, is the last one on the list tomorrow. There are more important fasts than this. But all the Chachamim ask the question, why we have this fast? There's many arguments about it. I saw all the answers, not all, but the major answers. It's really not convincing. Nobody really knows the truth, because the fast that Mordechai, that gathered all the children for 3 days to fast in Shushan, was in Nisan, not in Adar. So the timing does not match. So what is really the fast? Nobody really knows the answer. But it's mandatory. Why? Because once we have an halacha that is kept for 2,500 years, nobody has the power to dismiss it. And not that the fact that we don't know something, or we lost the information why we're fasting, or certain other things, still does not give us permission to come and be a judge in a court, in Sanhedrin, and say, you know what, I have the power to change the halacha. In order for the Beis Din, for the Jewish court, to change one halacha or one decree that the Chachamim made, they need to be larger in the number and larger in chokhmah, in their wisdom. And something like this will never really happen. Why? Because every generation is less wise than the previous one. That's number one. And second, where do you ever gonna gather all the chachamim to be 72 chachamim to sit together in one building? Is it possible today? If you want to bring 72 chachamim together to sit and decide that they would like to cancel the decree that you're not allowed to take shower on Shabbos with hot water. It's a decree. Because really today, with special heaters that we have, it's from the sun, or sometimes it's before Shabbos, you can close the faucet, and now you have hot water for Friday night as much as you want. Still not allowed to take showers with this, even though there's no Chilul Shabbos, because it's a decree. Okay, there's any way to lower the heat here? It has to be on. No, open the door a little bit. Thank you. So the point is, maybe speaking about hot water, I'm beginning to sweat here. But you need, first of all, to get 72 Chachamim. But the Chachamim has to be smarter, wiser than the Chachamim of 2,000 years ago. Where? It takes 7,200 Chachamim, there won't be one Chacham that was sitting in Sanhedrin. The Chachamim of Sanhedrin, it's not only that they knew the entire Torah, they knew astronomy, they knew the moon, the calculation, they knew so many things, they knew all the languages. Chacham in Sanhedrin has to know all the languages that the Jews speak. Bukharian will do the trial in Bukharian. Russian, Russian. Every language you come, hey, Rabbi, we have a problem. He killed my sister. What language you speak? Chinese, no problem. Chacham comes, he speaks to you Chinese. That's the Chachamim. They speak in the language of the people, in a court. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about Purim. So first of all, tomorrow the fast starts, I think, 5:30 in the morning, 5:35. That's Alot HaShachar, dawn, sunrise, actually before sunrise. 5:37, 5:35, that's the beginning of the fast until the stars appears. When is it? Like half an hour after Shkia, 7:35. It's over. But when it's over, you can drink something. You're going to be in shul. They're starting to read the Megillah right away, which is another 40 minutes. So you can eat something before. You don't have to suffer while you're hearing the Megillah. You can have a cookie or something or some drink to relax you a little bit before. And that's it. Now, you know, Purim and Chanukah, it's two holidays that made by the rabbis. Each one of them is different than the other. On the mutual thing to Purim and Chanukah is that the Goyim had a decree to destroy us. But there was something different about the decrees. The Greeks did not want to destroy us physically. They didn't want to kill us. They would prefer that we'll become Greek and leave Judaism. And not only they won't kill us, they give us everything we want. You'll be one of us. You get a job, we'll promote you, we won't touch you, you'll be a part of us. No discrimination. So they wanted to finish us spiritually. Aman wanted to destroy us physically, kill children, kill men, women, everybody. Because the decree in Purim was physical decree, because of that, the mitzvot of Purim connects to the body. To eat, to make a meal. Chanukah, you don't have a mitzvah to sit and eat meat and drink wine. You can do all the 8 days of Chanukah without any meal. You don't have an obligation to make a meal. Purim, you have an important meal. On Friday, we have to make a meal. This year, because it falls on Friday, it's a problem because you cannot be full when you enter Shabbat. Usually, if it falls on Wednesday, you can do the meal 2, 3, 4, whenever you want. You can be full in the evening, no problem. But now it's Erev Shabbos. You have to come at 8, 8:30 or 9 o'clock to start your meal. If you're going to start your Suda at 3, 4, you eat so much, comes the Kiddush of Shabbat, you'll be full. So what do we do? It's good to do the meal 11 o'clock. You bring meat, a lot of wine. Okay, now there's a mitzvah to drink wine. There's no mitzvah to be drunk. Even though it's all a machloket, there's machloket between the chachamim. Some say literally you have to be drunk. Some say no, you have to be mevusam. Mevusam means to drink enough that you feel that you're in a good mood and, you know, it's the beginning of being drunk, but not really drunk. Today, there's no question. Today there's no mitzvah to be drunk. Why? I once spoke to a non-Jewish person, and he told me that he works in a hospital, and on Purim day there were so many people were brought into the hospital after they were getting drunk and falling and getting hurt. And that's big chilul Hashem. Just imagine the doctors go in the emergency room. They see 20, 30 drunk guys coming with beard and black hat, come into the hospital. They all drunk like this, scream, laugh, cry, whatever they do, like the way they behave. It's a big chilul Hashem. One little chilul Hashem of a second, the whole Purim should go down to the garbage. It wasn't worth it. Remember, Chilul Hashem is the worst problem. If a Jew makes Chilul Hashem, it was worth it not to have Purim. It's a big problem, Chilul Hashem. Should know one thing, Moshe Rabbeinu, everybody asks this question, what was the problem with Moshe Rabbeinu? Why Hashem got so angry at him? He made a few little mistakes. It's not even mistakes, a sin. You cannot even call it a sin. Okay, so what are we going to call it? A mistake. But it wasn't even a mistake. He really listened to Hashem. He was using his common sense as the leader of Israel. Hashem came to him and said, go speak to the rock, and the rock will give you water. So what's the story? He went and hit the rock twice. That's the story. And then the water started to come out. The truth, that this is not the whole story. That's the headline of the story. What really happened over there? When Moshe came and he told the nation, I'm going to get you water out of this rock. Everybody thirsty, don't worry. In a few minutes, you're all going to have water as much as you want, for you, for your animals, for everything. Came Datan and Aviram, and all the clowns, they had a group of people that everything Moshe says, right away they instigate. Don't believe him. He's a shepherd. He knows every rock here. What do you think? He already know where the spring water is supposed to come. It's black with his rock. Once he's going to do a trick here, the water is going to come out of this rock. Because he knows there's water underneath. Let's see your great leader getting us water from that rock. If he gets us water from this rock, no question asked. Then he's really a proof that he's the messenger of Hashem. They saw everything. Nobody becomes religious from seeing miracles. Look at what's going on out there. The next day, they already forget about the miracle. A week later, they begin to explain. You know what happened? There was pressure coming from the Middle East, from the ocean. It created pressure, so the steam came out. There was a hurricane somewhere, and this happened. They'll find a way to explain the miracle. That's how it is. But forget about this one second. So Moshe now is thinking, Hashem told me to speak to this rock. They're already announcing that if water is going to come out of this rock, nobody will be impressed. But if I'll get them the water from that rock, they're all going to do everything Hashem say to me. So what's the point? For Hashem, it really doesn't matter from which rock to get the water. Well, where is the water come from? It's a miracle. Hashem has a problem to make the miracle here, but not here. What's the problem? And if I'll do it here, what benefits will I have? So I might as well, I have no choice. I gotta go by what they say. I'm gonna get them the water from there, and then finally, hopefully, I'll get rid of their nonsense. So he turned to the rock. He came to the rock, and speaking to the rock, nothing happened. Then he hit the rock, still nothing happened. There was few seconds between the first time he hit the rock until the second time he hit the rock. 10 seconds, 30 seconds, nobody really knows how long. That was a short period of time. And those 20, 30 seconds, the entire nation were laughing, pointing at him like this. Look at him. Look at this nonsense. We told you. Those 20, 30 seconds, there was big chilul Hashem, made the decree on Moshe Rabbeinu not to enter the land. Nothing helped him anymore. 515 prayers of the greatest Jew ever lived. Hashem did not forgive him. 22nd of Chilul Hashem is a big thing. You have to sweat 20 million years to erase it, this 22nd. If the entire nation saw a Chilul Hashem, if the whole world see a Jew on television for doing something wrong, wow. What a poor guy. Look at him. If you know what he's going to face later on for this 22nd, 100%. Now you should hear what you just said. If Moshe Rabbeinu that meant Leshem Shamayim and sacrificed his life for this nation and made one time a mistake, he called them Shim'una Amorim. Listen, you fools. That was one mistake. And another place he said, Ki am kshe orefu. Lashon Hara, because when you say the truth about somebody, it's Lashon Hara. If it's not the truth, that's called Motzi Shemra, ruining his reputation. But if you say something, it's the truth, that's called Lashon Hara. So he said two words of Lashon Hara about the Jewish nation. Jewish nation. Am kshe oref, stubborn. It's a stubborn nation. Then one time that he hit the rock, the wrong rock, whatever. That's it. That's Moshe Rabbeinu. How much he did more. And that's it. When he meant well, and Chilul Hashem came out of it, and there was such a tremendous problem, just imagine for all the rest, how much Chilul Hashem could be. So to be drunk, to go to the hospital, for sure not. So everybody knows he drinks and he is losing control. He's not allowed to drink. He drink enough just to be in a good mood and finished. Anyway, believe me, even if you be very drunk, you still be able to tell the difference between Arur Haman and Baruch Mordechai. I tested it. I asked those fools. They go like this, vomiting all over the rug. Excuse me, mister, who is cursed? Haman or Mordechai? Haman! Why you say Lashon Hara about Mordechai? I think they even know better. It's a secret, you know, how Haman, Baruch Mordechai, if you drink, you think that's going to make the difference? I heard all kinds of nice explanations about it. What does it really mean? All right, so just let's conclude one thing at a time. So it's mitzvah, like I say, tomorrow we fast, we finish it, we go right into the reading of the Megillah. What happens if you have a family event or something important? The Torah and the Halakha comes before your parents. If your parents tell you, I need you to help me, don't go to hear Megillah, you're not allowed to listen to them. You have to do the mitzvah no matter what. This mitzvah, it's so important that they even close the yeshivot. Thousands of people, tens of thousands of people close their books. Every second of Torah, it's a big mitzvah. We once calculate that in 1 minute, 1 minute, you can do 1,000 mitzvot by reading Torah. 1 minute, 1,000 mitzvot. You're closing the book by the time you get to the shul to hear the Megillah. By the time the Megillah will be finished, by the time you come back to your yeshiva, it perhaps will take more than an hour. So in 1 hour, you're going to lose 60,000 mitzvot from the Torah to hear one mitzvah of the Rabbanan. I guess it's really important, that mitzvah. Right? Because Bitul Torah is the worst sin, to just close the book and waste time. Or you have the opportunity to learn and you're wasting your time on nonsense. That's called Bitul Torah. And Hashem Baruch Hu is not so easy mochel al Bitul Torah. What do you see? That mevatlim everything to come hear Megillah. Why? The concept of Megillah is to praise the miracle that Hashem did to the Jews. Now, because the decree was to kill physically, to kill the Jews physically, that's why we have an obligation to enjoy with our body in Purim. You understand? And that's why we eat and we do all kinds of things that connects to the body. But in Hanukkah, the decree wasn't to kill the Jews, just to get them out of Judaism. So the decree was a spiritual decree. That's why in Hanukkah we do Hallel, spiritual things, more prayers, and we have no obligation to make a meal in Hanukkah. Why? The body did not suffer in the time of the Greeks. In the time of Haman, the body really suffered. You should know, there's a lot of questions about the Haggadah, about the actual things of Purim. There's hundreds of questions, very hard questions. Only a year after the miracle of Purim happened, the Chachamim agreed to make it a holiday. When it happened right away, the Chachamim didn't want to make it a holiday. Esther and Mordechai was pushing, begging the Chachamim to make it an official holiday. The Chachamim refused. Only a year later, when they saw the light with the Ruach HaKodesh, that there is something big in Shamayim in the time of Purim, they agreed to do it. Why the Chachamim refused to do it? Because the Chachamim was afraid that the Goyim will get angry at us, that we celebrate their destruction. Because remember, the Jews went and killed 300 of the labor of Haman. Haman was a big anti-Semite. And he has a group of people that was with him. And remember, when he came to King Ahasuerus, what was his words? There is a nation that is spread all over the world. Ahasuerus was in charge of 127 countries. And in each one of them, there were Jews. So he comes to Ahasuerus and he says to him like this. There's a nation that is spread all over. That's already a miracle. What nation is spread all over the world? Why they're not together? They're not such a big nation. But they have communities everywhere. It's like cancer. How's cancer spread everywhere? This nation is everywhere. And they speak a weird language. What is it? Yiddish, Hebrew, language. Nobody understands their languages. Everywhere they go, they have special language. You come to Europe, everybody speaks German, they speak Yiddish. You come to Poland, everybody speaks Polish, they speak Yiddish. They're unique. And their clothes is different than everyone. He was highlighting the differences between the Jews to all the other nations. Gemara says, there was a story about Ktia Bar Shalom. When the Romans occupied the whole world, so they came to Israel, and the Caesar, he asked his advisor, someone who has a problem in his leg. It's called Nemek. Nemek means there's no blood circulation in a part of your body, and eventually you become numb until you have to cut it off. What's the name of it in English? Gangrene? Gangrene. Yeah. It's called Nemek. No blood, no... It becomes blue and black until you gotta cut it. If you don't cut it, it kills the whole body. Gangrene, that's the name? So now, the king asks his advisor, a person that have this gangrene, okay. Whatever. So, sometimes I feel I have to put a stone in my mouth that the words will come out more Americanized, you know. Anyway, so now the king says, listen, someone who has this problem in his leg, what's better, to cut the leg or to try to keep him alive as long as possible, even though it's the problem spread to the rest of the body? So, all the advisors right away knew what the king is speaking about. What was he really speaking about? He says the world is one body. The world is one body. And because it's one body, there is a nemek in one part of the body. What's the name of this? It's the Jews. It's like a bone in the throat. I came to Israel, I have this little nation here, like a pin in the neck. What do I do? Do I destroy them for no reason? I just destroy them? Or I live with them, even though it's bothering me? So all the advisors of the Goyim, they told him, oh, if you have a nemek, you gotta cut it right away. It's dangerous. It spreads. If you leave these Jews here, they're gonna start spread to the rest of your kingdom. They'll make you a lot of problems. Get rid of them right away. That was their answer. But there was one goy. His name was Ktia Bar Shalom. Ktia. Ktia said to the king, no, it's better not to cut it. Why? If you cut it, the rest of the body will say, the rest of the world will say, you couldn't even handle such a little problem. So you needed to kill them. You couldn't deal with such little nation, 2 million people. You occupy the whole world. from these 2 million people you're afraid of? No, in history, they'll remember you as a coward king, that you occupy the whole world, but with a little nation like this, that it doesn't even have an army, you couldn't handle them. You needed to kill them for no reason. It drove him crazy. So the Caesar told him, you know, you're a very good speaker. So let's maybe we'll give you a job. You speak on TorahAnytime.com. No, believe me. He didn't offer him the job. So he said, you won the arguments against the other advisors, but someone who makes the king looks like a fool must be killed. So please take him and kill him. There was one Goyish woman, non-Jewish woman, standing over there. Now she needs to give him a message, but she's afraid, because, you know, if they're going to find out that she's giving him an advice, they'll kill her with him. So she started to sing. How sad that there's a boat that's full of merchandise, and it goes all the way to another country. It reached the border, and then they say you have to pay duty, tax, for the merchandise you bought. And they say, we forgot to bring our money with us. So what happened to the boat? They send them all the way back to their country now, 3 months in the ocean, to go bring the money. They cannot enter. They reach all the way to the entrance to the new country, and they can't pay the duty. What was the message? The message is, you fool. You got all the way to the gate of heaven. You're about to join the nation of eternity, this nation of God, the chosen people. And you don't have to pay, you don't have enough to pay your duty. What's your duty? Circumcision. You cannot enter Olam Haba without being circumcised. Arel. Arel lo chelek la'olam haba. There's no parts of the world to come. He got the message. 1 second that he had, he took a piece of rock, a tzur, he circumcised himself. And the Gemara says that an echo came and said, K'tia bar shalom is welcome to Olam Haba. K'tia. In 1 second, he got Olam Haba, this goy. Why? He gave a good advice for the Jewish nation. So what do we see from this? From these two stories. No, what do you learn from this story? Come Haman to Achashverosh. He's trying to show him the Jews, it's a Nemek in the kingdom, 127, you have cancer all over, get rid of them. And he convinced him. But the rest is well known. The miracle that Hashem turns, and usually this is the way it is. You should learn from this Megillah a very important message. When you prepare a pit for your friend, when you prepare a tree to hang your friend, when you prepare enough Lashon Hara to tell the boss about your friend that he's going to get fired and you're going to get promoted, usually you're going to dig your own grave. Usually this is how it works. It's interesting. In the way you plan it for somebody else, this is the way you fall down. It's all measure for measure. Measure for measure. What's the reason that the punishment for lepers, for Lashon Hara, it's leprosy? Tzara'at, what's the connection? What's the connection? I went and spoke Lashon Hara about Reuven. That's it. I made him such a bad reputation. I told all his secrets to the people. Nobody wants to get close to him. The next day I wake up, I see leprosy all over my body. Skin problems. What's the connection? I understand the tongue got cut in an accident. I understand he became mute. I understand somebody else spoke Lashon Hara more or less the same about him. That's measure for measure. What's leprosy has to do with that? Sometimes it's leprosy in the house, you know. We know we don't have it because we're not in a high level. And it used to be in a very high level. The miracles was clear. The same thing that they have bread falling from heaven. He came to his house, he see leprosy in the walls. It means he spoke Lashon Hara about someone. If he does not correct it, the next thing he comes to his clothes and then to his body. It goes in steps. Same thing here today. Today when Hashem wants to send a message, first your car goes kaput. It wasn't enough. Then you invested your money in Bernstein. 20 years of saving went down to the garbage in a minute. And it's still not, the message is still not clear. What comes next? The IRS put you 20 years in prison. If that's not enough, then they put John Gotti with you in the same room, like they do to our Persian friend. You understand? And if that's not enough, then they'll appeal in Texas to save your life. Maybe they'll be able to prevent the execution. That's how it is. It's step one step at a time, you know. You know the story when Melech Shlomo, one of his neighbors came and said, Rabbi, please teach me the language of the animals. So King Solomon told him, no, it's not for you. Believe me, you don't want to know. No, I'm curious. I see the chickens speaking every morning. I am dying to know what they talk about. What do you care, Rabbi? Do me that favor. No, yes, no. Okay, I'll teach you what they say. He started to teach him the way the animals communicate. One day he comes home, he sees the roosters, they're speaking today. Our master is going to have a big problem today. What happened? A thief is about to break into his bedroom and steal all his money from his safe. They used to hide the things inside the walls. They used to pull it and close it. He heard like this. He went and put bars on the window. Then he was waiting all day to see. Then in the afternoon, got evening, he see a thief is climbing on his window. Up, he see bars. The thief go out of his mind. Yesterday I checked the area here. It was all clear. What happened? How did he know this guy is a holy person? He has a Ruach HaKodesh. Or Ruach HaKotej. Depends. So, a week after, he hears the rooster speaking. Today, the son of our master is going to break his leg. He's going to cross the street, a horse will run and hit him. It's going to break his leg. He told his son, you don't move from here today. He handcuffed him to the bed. Gives him enough candy, food, Game Boy. Make sure he doesn't move. What happened? Nothing happened. He said, what is this king? He's not the smartest person ever lived. He's not smart at all. What? I wanted to know the language of the animals. He was convincing me not to know the language. Look at me. Already twice I got saved. What does he know? Then a week later, he hears the Malach HaMavet is about to come, take his life away. Or his son's life away. He runs to the king. King Solomon, you must help me. I heard the rooster saying that Hashem is coming to take my son's life away, or my life, whatever the case was. Told him, you fool, I was trying to save you. If you wouldn't know the language of the animals, what would happen? Then the thief will steal from you $10,000. What would happen to you? You would see that 1 year of saving went down the tube. It would make you make tshuva. A person that loses a lot of money, wake up. Why did Hashem did it to me? If he's tzaddik. If he's not tzaddik, he goes right away to find another person to steal it from. I lost, somebody else will pay it. I'm not going to lose. If he's a tzaddik, he's beginning to check. Why? Who did I steal from? Maybe I didn't do a kosher business. Maybe I cheat my customers. Maybe I cheat my partner. Maybe I cause somebody else to lose his parnasa. Maybe I'm not nice to my wife. There's a list in Shulchan Aruch. What are the reasons why people lose money? Maybe I take interest from other Jews. Maybe I don't give enough charity. Could be hundreds of reasons. He begins to check. Okay, so I gotta improve this. I have to improve this. I have to improve that. He begins to make tshuva. Hashem has no reason to break his son's leg. No more warning. First warning, you got the message. Hashem is not interested to make you suffer for no reason. You got the message. If it didn't help, next thing, the leg will be broken. That should help. Because it's now on the body. That's one step further. If this didn't help, oh, I'm sorry. That's the reason, by the way, that everybody asks this question. Hashem usually give a warning. Before a person gets killed, he gets a few warnings. One of the warnings is losing property, losing money. But the people of Dora Mabul, they did not get any warning. Hashem killed them right away. And the Gemara say, why they got killed? For gezel, for stealing. Why they got killed for stealing? Because the seven laws of Noah, you should know, the seven laws of Noah, one of them is you should not steal. A goy that steals, his punishment is worse than a Jew. A Jew that steals has to pay double if he gets caught. A goy that steals has a onesh mita, execution. That's how bad it is. The people of Dora Mabul, they used to steal. There was nothing to warn them. If the house is, Hashem makes a fire in your house, you get a damage, it wakes you up because it's yours. You lost the money. But if the house that you build is from stolen money or from cheating money, or you stole here and there and all this money it's stolen, it's not really your property. Even the clothes you're wearing, it's not yours. It belongs to other people. Then you don't have the merit to get a warning, because warning comes on your property. But if everything you have is stolen, it's illegal money, then where should I warn you in? I have nothing to warn you about. Because even everything you have, it's all not yours. Everything you have, it's not yours. You should know in Purim it's mitzvah to give mishloach manot to someone that you don't like. Not only to people you like. Don't go crazy with all these candies. It's good to give people something that they can see that it's kosher. If you brought them a cake, for instance, you make sure that you keep the wrap around it, that they see that it's kosher, because a lot of religious people that will see it, they don't see where it came from, they'll be embarrassed to call you and ask. They won't just not use it or give it to the goy. So you want to send something that shows that it's kosher. That's not one thing. You want to give a mishloach manot to someone who makes bracha on the food. If it's a person that eats without bracha, it's no mitzvah to give a mishloach manot. It's no mitzvah at all. You want to give to someone that makes the bracha. And if it's someone who doesn't make bracha, write him a note. Please, for my respect, make bracha on the food. This is mezonot, this is she'akol, this is borei pri hagefen, whatever you give them. It has to be two kinds of food. Okay, so you give to a man, your wife give to another man. We usually give to two people at least, two and two. Which means we give two kinds of food to one person and two to another person. The wife give to ladies, and that's enough. Some people give to 100 people. I have a list. The truth is, it's better to give to someone that you have an argument with. Someone that your relationship with him is not so great. That's an opportunity to make things warm again. Mitzvah to hear the Megillah, we said, in the morning, in the evening, and in the morning. If you heard in the night, you still have to hear in the morning. Where do they read in the morning? In Shachrit. So if you're not coming to Shul, to Daven on Shachrit, after the 18, right away, they read the Megillah. So in that case, it's going to be Friday morning after Shachrit. So if they daven, let's say, 8 o'clock, around 8:40, 8:35, after the 18, they open up the Megillah and they read. You have to hear every word of the Megillah. Even if you don't understand the language, if you heard all the words of the Megillah, it's Yotzei Lidei Chova, it's count. If you miss the Megillah, your only other option is to find a rabbi or someone who knows how to read, Baal Koreh, they're willing to come to your house and read it for you. Or to catch a later minyan that they read for the ladies in houses or in shul. Sometimes they make a later things. Then you come with the ladies, you hear it. You don't want to hear it with the men. You hear it when the ladies gather together. It's better than not to hear it at all. Okay, anything else? Oh, there's also mitzvah to give money to poor people. And people who learn Torah, it's even better. So if you know anybody poor that learns Torah, you can send through a messenger. You don't have to go yourself if you're embarrassed. You send it with a messenger to two of your name. So it has to be at least two. So you take whatever you can afford to give and you spread it to at least two people. And that's the mitzvah of Purim. Okay? So that's the mitzvah of Purim. You can do that. If you don't have money more than the maser, you can use some of the maser money to use it, to give it to tzedakah. Okay, let me tell you a story before we finish. If you have any more questions about Purim now, before I move on. It's better not to. It's mitzvah to sit with a family and a meal. If a person is afraid that they fire him from work if he doesn't go, or there's really an emergency, no, after he hears the Megillah, he goes to work. But we are not going to work. Nobody goes to work. Thursday? Thursday it's allowed to work, no problem. The holiday begins in the reading of the Megillah, when the fast is over. No problem, you can work.
And you still celebrate?
No, we don't do anything there. In other places, such as Yerushalayim, you know, they celebrate the next day. But here, it's a place, every place that was surrounded with a wall, in the time of the miracle of Purim, which is about 2400 years ago, then they read it in the next day, on the 15 days of Adar, not the 14. You understand? At night. So it's the day after that we do. So people in Tel Aviv, the people of Jerusalem do it the next day. So there's questions in the halakha. What happened if you live in Tel Aviv and you went for a few days to Jerusalem to your relatives? You have to read like the place where you live in. If you left knowing you're coming back to Tel Aviv and some kind of accident happened that you were forced to stay there, so you read like the people over there where you live. But if you went knowing you're going to be in Jerusalem for a week, then you have to read like the place where you come to. There's halachot in it. But that's of course not a shiur for halachot. Try to cover it generally. If you want to know the halachot, you open Shulchan Aruch, the halachot of Kriyat Megillah, and the laws of Purim, and Matanot Laevyonim, you have it in Yalkut Yosef also, you can read it over there. Amar Rav, in the time that HaKadosh Baruch Hu wanted to create Adam, He created a group of angels. There was no angels yet. He created a group of angels. Amar Laem, Retzonchem, are you interested, with your permission, he told the angels, are you interested that we will create a man in our image, speaking in a plural language, we should create a man in our image. They ask Hashem, what is he going to do, that man? What's going to be his nature? He says, Hashem started to describe what we are going to do. They told him, Ribono shel Olam, ma enosh ki tizkerenu? Why would you want to waste your time on such a creation, such a creature, like human being? Hashem heard their answer, this is all a mashal. An analogy. Hashem took his little finger, of course it's just an analogy, there's no fingers to Hashem, and burned them right away and destroyed them. No more angels, this group. Then he created another group of angels. They answered the same thing. Then he created a third group of angels. They say to him, Ribono shel Olam, Rishonim she'amru lefanecha ma'o ilu. What's the point that we're going to answer your question? Look what happened to the first two groups that answer you. We're afraid to talk. We don't want to know. We don't want to say anything. The world is all yours. Do whatever you feel like. They started to see all the generations in a vision. They started to see the people of Dora Mabul, those people that I just spoke about. Ve'anshe Dora Pelaga, those who made the tower, the Migdal Bavel, the Babylonian towers. They saw how wicked they were. They said, Ribono shel Olam, what did you have to do with the first two groups of the angels that you destroyed them like this? Didn't they tell you the truth? Look at these wicked people. They were right. What do you want from them? They have a good point, no? Amar Laem, Ve'ad zikna ani hu, Ve'at seva ani esbol. I have patience. I have patience for them. I have patience to tolerate them. Amar Rabbi Yehuda Amar Rav, Adam HaRishon, first Adam that Hashem created, was huge, from one side to the other side. From the time Hashem, that's the Pasuk say, Leminayom Asher Bara Elokim Adam Al Haaretz, Lemikze HaShamayim VeAtkze HaShamayim. From one side of the world to the other. After the first sin that he made, Hashem touched him and lowered him to be a regular sized person, like we are today. And you should know, one thing you should remember from this story. First Adam, his ankle was shining more than the sun. When the angels saw him, they thought this is God. Then when they realized this is Adam HaRishon, they were making him shish kebab from morning to night. Not a joke. They're making his food. The angels were making him food to eat. After they made the sin. Now also, he was all made from a nail. There was no flesh like here. It was all like shining diamond. Shining. The brightness of the sun on the nail, something so shiny, it looked like a diamond. After he made the sin, we became normal. Now we are temporary, because you know nails can stay forever. It wouldn't get old. You'd be covered with nail, you didn't need surgeries, plastic surgeries. Look, I'm 20 years younger now. You would be young forever, and you shouldn't die. Only after the first sin that came to Adam, to humanity. But what's the sad part here? He left us a souvenir, these nails, you see? What's the reason that when we cut our nails, it's so dangerous where we throw them? They say that if you throw your nails, there are three levels on people who cut their nails. By the way they behave with their nails, you see what kind of righteous people they are. One group of people, they cut their nails and they throw it wherever they cut it. That's wicked people. Then you have righteous people, they cut the nails, and what happened? They bury it. They make a hole in the ground and they bury it. Today we call it throw it in the bathroom and flush the water. That's called bury it. Yes. And the last group, it's Hasidim. That's even above righteous people. They burn it from the face of the earth. Why it's better to burn it than to bury it? Because when you bury it, it could be 1,000 years under the ground. One day somebody digs over there. It all comes out. So what's the problem if it comes out? If a pregnant woman will walk over it, she can lose her baby. What's the connection? What's the connection? Why? Because in the nails, there's ruach ra'ah. Bad spirit sticks to the nails. We have nails in our hand and in our feet. That's it. Really, when we wake up in the morning, when we make the first netilah that we do every morning, we make 3 and 3. According to the Zohar, it's 4 and 4, according to Kabbalah. So we are able to get rid of the bad spirit that sticks to our nails. So why don't we do for the feet? We also have nails over there. Because the ruach ra'ah of the feet is so strong, you can wash until tomorrow, it won't leave. It's always stuck to the feet. That's why if you touch the feet, right away you need to wash your hands. Even if you're very clean. Just came out of the shower. They just did pedicure, manicure to your nails. Believe me, they even spray perfume on it. Wow, you've never been so clean. You touch it, you need netila. It's ruach ra'ah, nothing to do with dirt. Yeah, it's true, in the old days when they used to come from the road, remember there was no cobblestone or hard floor. It was all dusty roads. So they used to wear kilts, so all the dirt used to go under the kilt and make their feet full of dust. So when they used to come to the house, the first thing they used to do, bring water to wash their legs, like in Avraham Avinu. First thing he does, he brings water. Why? Because when you come from the road, you want to get rid of all the dust. But the major reason why when you touch your legs is for this bad spirit. And when you cut the nails, the bad spirits, the ruach ra'ah, stick to the nails, whatever it is. Now what happened? Why? Because they go crazy when they see nails. Why? Because Adam HaRishon, before he made the sin, was all nail. Now nail, it's a sign of how Adam used to be. They're very jealous with this. It's interesting. But the worst part is, what's the connection to a pregnant woman? Because when a pregnant woman walks, what happened inside her stomach? There's a little baby, no? What is this baby doing? Learning Torah with an angel. All the secrets of the Torah for 9 months. When she walked over it, this Ruach Ra'ah see that the baby is learning Torah over there just above their head, and Chas V'Shalom, they can make a damage. It's all connected. We don't see really the connection. Well, big deal, I throw my nails, somebody walk over it. That's the big deal. It's all connected.
So Mayim Achronim has the same connection.
Mayim Achronim, it's another problem. When you do Mayim Achronim, according to the Pshat, according to Shulchan Aruch, the reason for Mayim Achronim, because in the old days, they used to have to bring the salt from Sodom. Sodom and Gomorrah, you know that area? It's called Melach Sodomit. The salt over there is so strong, they used to take the bread and dip it 3 times in the salt when they made a motzi. And then what happened is some salt stays on their fingers, and a person without realizing is itching his eyes and can become blind from it. It's so strong, this salt, it's very dangerous for the eyes. So they made a takana that after he finished to eat the bread right away, he's doing Mayim Achronim, he has to wash his fingers. But according to the Kabbalah, every mitzvah is risen according to the Kabbalah also. According to the secret is that the Satan goes crazy when a Jew sits in a table, wash his hands, mitzvah number one, then make a motzi, mitzvah number two, eats kosher food, mitzvah number three. Now he finished, while he's eating, he makes divrei Torah on the table, because someone who sits and eats without saying divrei Torah, it's count like he eat dead bodies. That's what it says. Keilu ochel mizivchei metim. So now he made divrei Torah on the table. Now he comes to make bracha. Ve'achalta ve'savata uverachta et Hashem Elokecha. It's bracha from the Torah. 5 such important mitzvot, when the last one is the most important one, the Birkat Hamazon, the Satan goes crazy. So what happened? You see in the Siddur of the Ben Ishchai, it goes according to Kabbalah, he wrote over there, this is the part of us that goes to the Satan. For whatever reason, we don't know why, it's Kabbalah stuff. When you give this little water, when you wash it and you throw it, this water, it's called Mayim Achronim, it's relaxing the Satan. He relaxes. If not, he goes crazy. That's Kabbalah. We don't need to know all the reasons for Kabbalah. Kabbalah, it's beyond our understanding. The simple reason is, it's halacha. In Shulchan Aruch, halacha I gotta do. What difference does it make? Why? Whether I understand, whether I don't understand. That's what I have to do. Yes?
I don't know if the things that the rabbis made were applying to us, because today we have technology involving different things. I don't know if they had in mind something that was applying to them. They had in mind for us.
Okay, first of all, if you simply analyze each one of their decrees, almost all of them does not apply to today's generation. Does not apply. We have 2 problems. Problem number one, we don't know all the reasons that made them make that decree. We may know 1 or 2 reasons which does not apply today. But there could be many hidden reasons that we will never know. We never knew and we will never know. So therefore, the fact that we are convinced that it does not apply anymore today doesn't mean that we're right. And even if we are 100% right, 100% right, didn't you hear what I say in the beginning of this lecture? In order for the Chachamim to cancel a previous decree that the Chachamim made, they must have to sit down a bedin like Sanhedrin, larger than Sanhedrin, more than 71 Chachamim, and the Chachamim must be greater than the Chachamim that made the decree. Do you know anybody in today's generations that can be smarter or wiser than Rabbi Akiva, than Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai? If Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai will come for a visit, you know what would happen to all the rabbis? You know what would happen? They will all take vacation for 2 months, hoping you forget that they exist.
Okay,
I'll be the first one who fly to Acapulco. Where is it? Whatever it is. Just from the embarrassment. You know why? You know why, right? You don't know why? You know, you have all kinds of levels of rabbi, even today, right? You have one rabbi, he speaks very nice. It's not such a big Talmid Chacham. You ask him question, halachot. Sometimes he knows, sometimes he doesn't know. Either he answer you foolish answer, or he say, I don't know. Depends how honest he is. Sometimes he say, I have to check, call me back tomorrow. And that's one rabbi. Sometimes you have a rabbi that is much, much greater. Every question you ask him, right away like a computer. Oh, no problem. Yeah, check here, check there. Open that book. That rabbi speaks about it like a computer. So now, when the computer rabbi is not around, the first rabbi is bragging about him, his title. Ooh, I'm somebody important. Once that real rabbi is coming to town, that's highlight what a loser is the first one. You understand? And that's how life is all about. It's the same thing in computer, the same thing in medicine. You have a little simple doctor. He knows that every problem you have, two Advil, twice a day. Then a professor came, such a genius, a brain surgeon. He knows everything about medicine. He's a well-known, he's the Rambam of today's generation. What happened to the first doctor? He goes to visit his mother in Florida for 2 weeks. He's embarrassed to be in the same thing. You know? I remember once, 12 years ago, 12 years ago, I was invited to speak in Mill Basin in Brooklyn. And there was one rabbi over there, Hashem will forgive me, I didn't even know who he is. I didn't know who he is. So... You know, we're sitting there, they made a table, all the rabbis are sitting. Now, I wanted to give my lecture and leave. I didn't want to wait until all the rabbis will talk. By 12 o'clock, I'll be finished by the time I get to Muncie. So I was telling the woman in charge over there, do me a favor, let me be the first one who speaks, because I have a long ride home. You know, they're all local here. By the time I get home, they'll finish their speech. So Me and her, we both didn't know really who this rabbi is. So she said, no problem. So she made me speak first. Everybody couldn't believe. Only when I finished my speech, when the second rabbi came and I realized who he is, I didn't know where to hide myself. I said to myself, what a fool. Why did I have to open up my mouth? You know, who was this rabbi? Rav Ben Zion Mutzafi. One of the three most important Sfaradim rabbi in the world. Big Talmid Chacham, the son of Rav Salman Mutzafi. His father is a big Mekubal. He's a big Rosh Yeshiva, big Talmid Chacham. He's on the radio everywhere. He has books. Even in the government, they already mentioning his names. How, you know, he say this, he say that. It's very important, Rav. That's what happened. If Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai will come, all the rabbis will run away to a convention in Las Vegas, over there. And they'll call to make sure when Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai leaves town, a month later, maybe they begin to return. So you want today a Beit Din will cancel the decree of 2,000 years ago? It was designed in a way that nobody can cancel it. So when Mashiach comes, we'll see. By the way, why to cancel if we get reward for it? Why are we so anxious to cancel mitzvot? Why? The opposite. The Torah says, what do we say in the davening every day? Ratza HaKadosh Baruch Hu lezakot et Yisrael, lefichach hirba lahem Torah u'mitzvot. What does it mean? Hashem wanted to reward the nation of Israel, therefore He made them a lot of laws. We think it's a punishment. Wow, Rabbi, there's so many things to do. It's a reward. What are you complaining? What is it like? Two friends are looking for a job. They're both broke. So they go to a job interview. One guy went to a supermarket in town. The other one went to a supermarket in the next town. So one guy, he got a part-time job, 2 hours a day. You come 9 o'clock in the morning, 11 you're done. The other guy has to come 9 o'clock in the morning, he finished 9 o'clock at night. And they're both going to make $10 an hour. So after 2 days of work, they meet on the street. How are you doing? I have such a great life. I come, I get up in the morning, I go to the supermarket. By the time I get there, I finished. 11 o'clock, I'm on my way to the beach. Every day I enjoy the sun. The other guy, what's with you? Oh, I have such a hard life. I get there at 9 o'clock in the morning, I leave at 9 o'clock at night. 12 hours like a slave. You fool! Why you agree such a thing? A third guy is listening to the conversation. He says, he's a fool, you both fools. You and him, I'm not sure which one is worse. It all goes by money. Money talk. How much you making? $20 a day. He makes $120 a day. What can you achieve in life? What can he achieve in life? He has a car you don't have. You know why? Because you only work 2 hours a day. When you come to get a job, everybody understands the more hours, the better it is. What are you going to give me, 2 hours a day? Not interested. You want to be a teacher in our school? Yes. Okay, you'll be a substitute. 2 hours a day. We'll call you when we need you. Just the gas and getting there will cost him more than what he's going to make. If they give him 10 hours a day, it's very good. He makes money at least, right? Why? He likes to work. Nobody wants to work. If you can get the same money without going to work, you would still go to work? Huh?
No.
So what's the point here? The more mitzvot, the more you earn. Why do you complain? Why you complain? The more mitzvot, the more you're earning. Same thing with suffering. You know the story with the king. The goy was beating up the Jew. The king saw it. He arrested the goy. The Jew was taking care of the Jew, treating him. When he made the trial, he said to the goy, for every time you hit him, you have to give him $1,000. And he hit him 100 times. So now the Jew is going to get $100,000. The Jew started to cry. The king said, why are you crying? I'm not a fair judge. He said, no, Your Honor, you're better than fair. You're the greatest. So what's the problem? It reminds me about the joke. A Persian or Bukharian, you choose, whatever you want. He was standing in a bus, waiting for a bus, and he was crying. An old lady came, she said, what happened to you, young guy? Why are you crying? He said, everybody has money for the bus. I don't even have money for the bus. She said, no problem. It's only $2. I'll pay for you. So she paid for the fare. He got on the bus and he was crying inside the bus again. So she came to him and said, why are you crying now? He said, everybody got changed. I'm the only one didn't get changed. You know, Persian, Russian, Bukharian, whatever you want. It's only a joke. He told his father, Dad, today I save you the $2 for the bus. So how come? He said, I ran after the bus. Instead of taking the bus, I ran after the bus. I practiced. So he told him, you fool, why didn't you run after a cab? Anyway, so now, where were we? In a story. So the king said, I'm not a fair king. Time is up. We're going to... I'm not a fair king. So no, you're more than fair. But if I only knew that for every time he hit me, I'm going to get $1,000, I would bend down like this and tell him, more, more. I wish I knew. That's what the Torah says. Ka'asher ye'yaser ish et bno, kach Hashem elokecha miyasreka. The more suffering you get here, the more reward goes into your account. And yet, after hearing it for 5,000 times, if tomorrow you get a ticket, you begin to cry. I can't take this anymore, Rabbi. I cannot stand this. I must get married. How much more I can suffer? Well, Hashem doesn't see how much I'm suffering. What is this? I'm not Eov. Eov was a strong man. I can't take this anymore. Huh? I can't. Business is not doing well. How long are we going to suffer? No, anybody has more complaints about his suffering? Maybe now it's the time.
Yeah. Like you mentioned that we have to get rid of the nails properly. Is this the same goal for the hair?
hair has dinim in it, not for ladies, for men. Men that raise his hair long and has a high blorit or ponytail ruins his luck in life. Automatically, if he makes money, he makes less money. Problems in everything he does, he has problems because he has din on him. That's why the halacha in Shulchan Aruch is the first thing you do to a Baal Tshuva, someone who accepted to become religious, first two things you do with him, before you teach him about Shabbat, about Tefillin, before you check his mezuzot, before all of that, you give him a haircut, get rid of his hair, and you bring him into the mikveh. Even though none of them, it's a mitzvah from the Torah. Why the Shulchan Aruch didn't say, right away, make him learn about Shabbat, not to be Mechal Shabbos anymore. Two things. First, cut his hair, get rid of all the impurity that hold to him all these years, and right after that, put him in a mikveh. That will be like a recreation for him. Become a new person. There's something in the mikveh. You go in Chris, you become Avram. Psh, what a magic. Think about it. He went inside Yitro. He came out, father of law Moshe Rabbeinu. Ma. It's not a joke. Just he was a goy. Now he became a Jew. Going into the water and coming out. It's a big thing, this water, the mikveh. A woman in a state of impurity, nida. The Zohar says it's worse than dead body. That's the impurity of nida. She goes into the pure water, comes out, she becomes a pure new creation. Unbelievable. The power of mikveh. Who knows why? Yes?
Would you recommend the forest fucking nail? What's the best way to do that?
To flush it down the toilet. It's like burning it today. Yeah, because it will never come out, because everything that goes to waste, goes to waste, that's it.
But what do you say, says it's mutar to grow up your hair, no?
He doesn't say it. Having long hair in the front, there's another problem, that the tefillin does not touch the scalp. And that's a problem, because it's supposed to touch the scalp of the head, the tefillin. So having high hair here makes the tefillin stands in the air. Tefillin must touch the head. You don't need. It's enough the hair goes on the side like this and you pull it, it's fine. But if it's too high and too long, especially if you put tons of spray, because last night you went to the club.
On the hair or on the skin?
On the skin, not on the hair. On the skin. It touched the skin. If you pull it on the hair falls down, it touched. Eventually it touched the head.
How come you cannot
put? Not supposed to put here. You have to put above the hair. Because the eyes, this eye start here, and this eye start here. When the Torah says between your eyes, there's an eye right here and an eye here, and it has to be right in between the eyes. That's why we don't put the big tefillin like the Chabad. Looks like a watermelon. You know that big tefillin? Because this is on the eyes, not between the eyes. The Torah says between the eyes. How can you put something so big? It's on the eyes. You understand? It's against the halacha. It's not like Shulchan Aruch. No, you have to get, if you're Sfaradi, you get a Sfaradi tefillin. If you're Ashkenazi, it's also better to get Sfaradi tefillin. No, not because we're Sfaradi, because that's the truth. Yeah, I know I have a lot of Ashkenazi friends, rabbis, they put Sfaradi tefillin. Even Rabbi Deret, one of his pairs is Sfaradi. My chevruta, Rabbi Schwarz, that came in, we have Sfaradi tefillin. Sfaradi, not because it's Sfaradi, because it's a cheetah of the Rambam, that's all.
What's the difference between
there's differences. There's differences in a tradition. Huh? Two tefillin is like the Mekubalim. You don't have to, don't worry. One at the time, it's good enough. Thank you very much. Good night. We're going to daven now, Arvit.